Hey, welcome back to Kevin Wilson SBC. I want to spend a few minutes today talking a little bit more about rear steer and preload, and let's talk a little bit about corner weights and scaling your race car. Please take a moment and subscribe to the channel. Please hit the little bell icon so you'll be notified when a new video is released. Now let's jump in. Let's get started talking about rear steer and preload. As we continue this series on rear suspension and our chalkboard session, rear steer is something more and more people are having to understand, especially with the power levels we're making today and the ability to put a lot of power to the rear end, and then the challenge of getting that power on the track and get the car hooked and going. Especially going straight. So you may notice I end all my videos with go fast, go straight, and be safe. If anything compromises safety, it's a no-go. So we got to be safe, safe, safe. And then we want to all go fast. However, the challenge is going fast and going straight while being safe. So rear steer is something you're going to run into more than likely at the power levels going on today, especially when you start having some of that torque really getting applied to the rear end. We talked in some earlier videos about all the dynamics and all the things that are happening on a rear end under load and under acceleration. Well, one of those is rear steer, especially with a four-link car, and it comes to preloading. You know, generally we always preload with the upper bar on the passenger side of a four-link rear end. With preload and moving that upper rear bar, all you're really doing is shifting weight left and right. However, at some point, you're actually binding up the four-link in the rear end. If you're having to go more than two flats or more than three flats of preload, let's pause and let's understand that. Let's make sure that the rear end is in alignment. Let's make sure that the rear end is centered in the car. Let's make sure that our wheelbases are equal. Let's make sure that our measurements from our brackets to our cross member are good. Let's really understand what's going on with the car and the corner weights. Every car can react a little bit different, but when you move that upper four-link bar, you're pretty much just moving weight around. If you shorten the upper passenger bar, you're adding weight to the right rear slick or radial, right rear tire. If you lengthen the upper bar on the right rear, the passenger upper bar, then you're adding weight to the left rear, the driver's side slick. When you shorten, you're adding weight to the right rear. When you lengthen, you are adding weight to the left rear. If you have a car that's driving left or right, you can use preload to shift some weight around. However, once you get past two to three flats of preload, pretty much all you're doing is binding the suspension up. And you need to step back and regroup on that, which is when we get into talking about rear steer and how do we use rear steer to correct a car that's going left or right. Okay, let's go back to my wonderful artistic abilities here and talking about rear steer. Let's look at a rear end from, if you're looking at the top of the chassis, and you got the front of the car up here, so you got the front end up here, you got the rear end back here, you got your rear end in here like this, and this is your engine up here. So this is the front and this is the rear. Okay, now in this picture here, let's assume the rear end is in square. So if we measure off of the brackets of the rear end to the cross member, it's the same on both sides. The wheelbase is the same on both sides. The rear end is centered in the car. The rear end is squared up in the car. So at this point, we have neutral rear steer in the car. Let's say you have a car that is going left. Well, if a car is going left on the hit, and as you're accelerating, the car is wanting to go left, there's a couple things you can do. That tells me the right rear is driving the car harder than the left rear. So I would want to move a little weight to the left rear slick. To do that, I would lengthen the upper right rear four link bar, a flat or two flats, and I would look at my scales and see how much weight I'm moving around. But I would shift some weight to the left rear slick. Let's say you did that and the car responded and it did help, but it's still going left. At this point, you could add more preload, but really all you're doing now at this point, once you get past two to three flats, is you're just putting more bind in the rear end. So let's talk about how can we get less bind in the four link and what can we do with the rear end to help the car come back to the center. In other words, stop going left. There are many, many, many articles, many YouTube videos that talk about rear steer, and 99% of them all use an analogy about a fork truck. And a fork truck applies here because most fork trucks, when you steer them, you're steering with the rear tires of the fork truck. And if you're not careful, you can make your problem worse if you don't understand the dynamics of rear steer. So we're talking about a car that's going left. In this example, we lengthened the upper right rear four link bar by a flat or two, maybe three, no more than three, and the car still goes left. It helped, but the car still goes left. At this point, what I would like to do is bring the preload back to neutral. Let's put the four link back to a neutral setting, and then let's add some rear steer. And what we're going to do, instead of the rear end being squared up in the car, I'm going to take the rear end. Now, I'm going to exaggerate this picture. Okay, this is an exaggeration. I'm going to take the rear end, and I'm going to cock the rear end this way. So I'm going to cock it to the left, which tells me this measurement from the bracket to the cross member is going to be further back than this bracket on the rear end to the cross member. So I've got the rear end cocked to the left. When you do this, you need to center the rear end back up in the chassis. You're going to have a track bar, you're going to have a panhard bar, you're going to have a wishbone, you're going to have some locator to locate that rear end in the chassis. So anytime you add rear steer, you're going to have to recenter the rear end in the chassis. Now, remember the fork truck analogy. It's easy to look at this and go, hey, my car's going left. I want to drive the car back to the right. So the natural tendency is to cock the rear end to the right. But if you do that, your car is going to go left harder. So the whole goal here is when you hit this rear end, the rear end is going to center itself up and push the car to the right. At this point, I am correcting with a little bit of rear steer. I've got my four link back in a neutral setting. I'm not binding things up. Let's talk a little bit more about rear steer and how much rear steer are we talking about here. If you're used to watching my videos, you hear me say a lot, keeping things in balance, keeping things in proportion. You want all of this working together. So a lot of people think, well, If I need some rear steer, let's put a freaking inch of rear steer in this thing. You're going to get yourself in trouble. When it comes to rear steer, the absolute most I'm going to put a car in rear steer, if you measure from the center line of the wheel to the center line of the front, and you start measuring how much rear steer do we have in this car, I am shooting on the outside. I am shooting for no more than a half inch of rear steer. If you're not careful and you start measuring on your brackets, depending on where your brackets fall in relation to the housing, if the closer your brackets are to the midsection, the center section of your rear end, that little bit of distance, if you move an eighth of an inch in here, that could easily equate to a half inch out here at the center line of the axle. So when I'm talking rear steer, and I'm talking a half inch or 3/8 of rear steer or a quarter inch of rear steer, I'm always talking about at the end of the axle tube. Remember, if you're measuring from your four link brackets to the cross member, and you're measuring there and you're on the inside of the tube, you're not on the outside, obviously, you need to remember that a little bit here equals a lot more out here. A half inch of rear steer is a lot of rear steer. Normally, we can get away with, 3/16 of an inch out here, an eighth inch of an inch out here. It doesn't take a lot of rear steer to straighten a car up. And the less preload I'm putting on the four link bars, the freer that suspension is to react and handle the forces for separation and what I'm trying to get to plant those slicks. So the goal is to not have to use a lot of preload. Like I said, I don't mind a flat or two flats. I'm not going to go more than three flats of preload on a four link setup. It's just binding things up too much. So with rear steer, at most we're talking about is a half inch, and a half inch is a lot of rear steer on a race car. Remember, if the car's going left, you cock the rear end to the left. If the car is going right, you cock the rear end to the right. Don't let that screw you up. Always think about how a fork truck steers with the rear wheels. And believe me, this works. So let's say we got a car that's going left. I can easily at the track add a flat or two flats of preload to the upper right four link bar, and I can lengthen that upper right bar to add weight to the left rear. And if your car is on scales and you move that upper bar a flat, you can actually watch the scale move, and weight moves pretty quickly when you use this method. You can move 40 to 50 pounds of weight quickly from one side to the next with one to two flats of preload. I'm going to start with preload and see if I can correct the car out, because at two flats, I'm not binding anything up terribly bad. But if I can't get it out with two flats of preload, max three flats of preload, I'm going to go back to neutral, and we're going to talk about rear steer. I can also use preload with wheelie bar settings to help straighten a car up. I'm running into more and more drag racers who are running in races that will not allow wheelie bars. So more and more in today's world, wheelie bars are coming out of the equation. Let's say I put two flats of preload in this car and it was still going left just a hair. I would lower the right rear wheelie bar about a quarter of an inch, 3/16 to a quarter of an inch. And with one to two flats of preload and with a little bit of wheelie bar stagger, I can usually take a lot of left or right hand pull out of a car. However, if you can't run wheelie bars or you choose not to run wheelie bars because of the type of racing or the class you're in, then if preload doesn't solve it, you got to go to cocking the rear end, which in essence is just rear steer. Let's talk a little bit more about scaling your race car and some tips I would give you on that. You can ask 10 different people, get 15 different opinions. I'm going to tell you what we do. Obviously, you have four scales. You have a scale for each wheel of your drag car. And what we do is we're on a level surface, and we have built blocks about 9 inches tall. We have four blocks. All blocks are 9 inches off the ground, and they're all four equal. Then we have, so we jack a car up, we sit the car on the blocks. Then we have another set of blocks that we have in front of each of those blocks. And these blocks are a little lower than these blocks. And on these blocks, we sit our scales. So the whole goal here is we get the car up on the block so that I can get under the car, I can do some measuring. I can use these blocks to put my numbers into the equation we talk about for instant center. I just have to remember, when I'm measuring from the ground to how high my bolt holes are, I have to remember to subtract the height of these blocks the car is sitting on. The slicks have air pressure in them, it's race ready, there's fuel in the tank, the driver's in the car, everything is ready, we're ready to make a pass. And I am measuring all of my bolt mount points. I'm measuring the camshaft height, if that's what I'm going to use for my height of my center of gravity. I do all my measuring. I know all four blocks are a set height and all four blocks are equal heights. I subtract that from my measuring, and then I start plotting instant center, my center of gravity, my anti-squat line. I begin to go from there and build my plotting. Once I have that, the car is on the blocks and settled. The scales are in front of each one of the tires at the same height with the scale is at the same height of the other block. The car, we then put in neutral, and we roll the car onto the scales after the scales are zeroed and on and ready to accept the car. That's important. Scales are on, scales are zeroed. We roll the car onto the scales, and ideally, you can do this one of two ways. Ideally, I like for the first weight on the scale to be with the driver in the car. Helmet on, fire suit on, ready to go. And then I capture those weights. We understand the cross section of the car. We understand front and rear weights. I understand all the corner weights. I document all that. And then at that point, if we want to make changes or we think we need to move weight around, ideally at this point, we've preloaded a car with it sitting on the scales. And the fun thing is, as you shorten or lengthen that upper rear four link bar, you can watch in real time the scale weights move, and you can watch those corner weights move. These weights move a lot quicker than people think. People who go out to the track and will go up there and just twist that upper bar a couple turns, to me that is scary as all get out, because that tells me they do not understand truly how much weight they're shifting around on that rear end. And at that point, in my opinion, you're getting out of balance and you're getting things out of whack. So this is how we scale a race car. Yes, we still use wired scales. We have a lot of wireless interference around our shop. We have a security company right next door. They have a lot of high-powered wireless cameras running. We've had wireless front-end machine racks before that we've sent back. We do our front-end alignments with an old-fashioned camber and caster bubble, tape measures. You know, bubbles and tape measures just don't lie. We talk all the time about videos, just don't lie. Videos tell a story. Well, these hardwired scales, I'm a little old-fashioned. I still use hardwired scales that come back to the control board, and I have instant communication with those scales. So this is kind of the process we go through on scaling a car. And also, with it off the ground 9 inches, I got a lot more room underneath there to check on things. You know, things loosen up under your race car. Are my heim joints tight? Do I see any cracking on my welds? Go through this stuff and make sure, are my shocks tight? where they mount to the rear end, where they mount to the frame. Are things tight? Do things look healthy? So this is rear steer, this is preload, this is scaling a car. Let's summarize this. We started off talking about preload, and we talked about how if you go to the upper right four-link bar and you shorten the upper right four-link bar, you are adding weight to the right rear passenger side slick or radial. If you lengthen the upper four-link bar on the right rear, the passenger side, you are adding weight to the left rear slick or radial of your car. So shorten, lengthen, and we talked about 2 to 3 flats max. If you're having to go more than 3 flats to straighten a car up that's going left or right, then if you have wheelie bars, let's talk about the combination of wheelie bars with preload. If you're not able to run wheelie bars, then we got to start talking about rear steer. So for a car that's going left, I would cock the rear end to the left. I'm going to point the rear end to the driver's side for a car that's going left. And that's going to drive the rear end, that's going to drive the car back to the right on the hit, and as long as you're running it. Now, no more at the end of the rear end, at the axle, I'm not wanting to go more than a half inch of rear steer. That is a lot of rear steer. Generally, an 1/8 inch to 3/16 will cure a lot of issues with left or right. And if you stay a half inch or less, you're not going to see any dog walking or crab walking. That's really not that severe. But you don't want to start going more than that, or you will start getting your car out of alignment. You're intentionally putting the rear end out of alignment at this point as far as left or right. But remember, when you add rear steer, you've got to relocate that rear end back in the center. You are purposely cocking the rear end in the car. And then we talked about how we at Samson Performance, how do we scale race cars, and we put them up on blocks. We have the scales in front of the tires that are the same height as the blocks with the scale there. We get the car settled. A lot of times when you jack a car up, if you jack it up under a cross member, you got shocks hanging, you got control arms hanging, you want to make sure the car's loaded and pressed back down and everything's settled back in place. And then once we get the scales on, we get the scales zeroed, we've confirmed the scales are accurate based on our standard weights that we have at the shop, then once we're ready and we've made all of our measuring, we'll roll the car onto the scales, we'll check our weights, we'll document our weights, and then if we want to move weight around, we're going to talk about preload, we're going to talk about wheelie bars, we're going to talk about rear steer. Those are the three main areas that I wanted to cover in today's video. Thanks so much for watching. Please remember to subscribe to the channel. Thank you for your support. I hope everyone has a great 4th of July, and I hope everyone is staying healthy. And let's end with this. Go fast, go straight, and be safe.